Hey folks, so I'm going to do an update on my entry into the next generation group build being hosted on the Warts and All Facebook group. This is my entry. It's supposed to depict the Soviet-Afghan war in the 80s. It may not exactly do that because my tank is a bit of a Franken-tank. It was a T-54B. But I've kind of stuck a bunch of bits on it there and changed a few things to sort of make it look like a T-55A, kind of. Anyone who knows a lot about these tanks, though, would look at it and go, that doesn't fucking look anything like that. Well, I'm aware of that, so. But either way, one of the things that I kind of like about this, when I was doing the research on this subject, the vast majority of the photos that I found were labeled Soviet tank, Afghanistan. It didn't even say what war or what year, so it could have been a modern picture, could have been a bunch of Taliban sitting on the tank. It could have been from the 80s. It was difficult to tell because nothing really changed in the last 35 years in that country, so and that's a terrible thing, that's the truth of it. I really wish that someone would have figured out by now how to make things better over there. By that I mean help the Afghanis figure it out for themselves, not us go over there and tell them what the fuck to do. But anyway, that's just me. So either way, one of the things that I thought was funny was I kept finding the photographs that just kept saying Soviet tank Afghanistan, Soviet tank Afghanistan. So this is my Soviet tank Afghanistan. Who knows what war it was, I guess. But I'm going to say it's the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan during the 80s. So either way, I'm going to have some figures in the tank and some figures on the tank and then some figures hiding in this building here ready to blow a hole in this tank and the fellas riding it. That's the plan. It'll have a funny name. That's also the plan, but that'll be later. But for all intents and purposes, the diorama is finished. I just have to finish the tank, and I have to finish the figures. The tank, it's just in its base paint. I haven't done any detail painting. All I've done is base color it and put the decals on. I was going to do a certain kind of chipping on this thing that a friend of mine, Nigel Wells, did in a video there just a couple of days ago. He used Marmite as a chipping fluid on his airplane that he just finished a lot of sorry, Nigel, I don't remember what kind of plane it was. It was one of them funny planes. What the fuck? The Lightning, I think it was called. P-38? Yeah, I'm not sure. It's a weird looking plane. Either way, he did a really cool chipping on there, and it looked awesome, and he used Marmite to do as the chipping agent. So I thought, well, I've got some Vegemite here. I'm going to give that a try and see if that works. I thought it'd be brilliant, right? If Nige can do it, I could probably do it, right? Maybe on armor? Armor's more forgiving than aircraft. But unfortunately, my Vegemite has gone off. It's spoiled, so I can't use it. I had two jars of it here. Someone gave it to me as a joke. They even dared me to eat it. And I've never eaten the Vegemite, but I have tried Marmite, and I will never associate that with food again in my entire life. It will never happen again. I will maybe use it as a chipping agent, but it will never go in my body. Ever. I might use it to patch piping when I have a leak, but I will never consume it. It's never going to happen. Nope. It's not food, as far as I'm concerned. So anyway, so I was going to use the Vegemite to try and chip this thing, but I'll have to wait until I can get some more. They sell it at my local grocery store for some reason, maybe for patching pipes, I'm not sure. But so I might get some more to give it a whirl on another vehicle, but I can't do it on this one because, like I said, it was spoiled, which kind of pissed me off a bit. So I'll more than likely use oils on this. Usually when I do chipping, I'll either use oils, I'll use acrylics, or I'll use the hairspray method. I tried Mascol a few times, but Mascol, I don't like it because it's clumsy. It's too difficult to get into fine detail, and it doesn't last. I have to buy things in bulk, because of where I live and save on shipping. And so the last time I bought Mascol, well, not the very last time, the first time I bought Mascol, I bought 4 bottles of the stuff, save on shipping. And so I cracked open a bottle and I used it. And I mean, it did its job, right? I mean, it masked what I needed it to mask. And then I put the jar, the cap back on. It's got a pretty robust container. It's a pretty tough container. And then I put it away. And then it was about maybe 3 or 4 weeks later, I opened it again to use it on another thing I wanted to mask. But it had all gone hard, right down to the bottom. It was all just solid blob of rubber. Now, I know it wasn't me because I put that top back on good and tight, and that bottle was sealed. I mean, like I said, it's a pretty robust bottle. So I thought, well, maybe it was just a bad bottle. So I threw it in the garbage, and I opened one of the other 3 bottles that I had, and it was also hard. I'm like, oh, okay. So I opened the last 2, and they also were toast. So I thought maybe it was just a bad batch, right? So I ordered 2 more bottles from a completely different place and tried them. The first bottle was fine for about a week, and then I opened it again a week, and it started to harden at the top. And I was pretty sure if I had waited any longer, it would have hardened all the way to the bottom. And so I left it, and I put the cap back on, and I waited another week, and I took it off, and it had hardened all the way to the bottom. And the other one had hardened all the way to the bottom, too, and I hadn't even opened it. So, for me, Mascol is a wasted product. I can't. It might work for other people, but it's useless to me, so I can't use Mascol. There's another version. It's similar to Mascol, but it's got another brand name. I can't remember what it was. I had that first. Somebody gave it to me, and I tried that, and it did the same thing. It just didn't do it as fast as Mascol, but it was very similar. It's like a vinyl paint, and it dried out also very quickly. So I don't use that. Normally, I'll use paint to do my chipping, and occasionally, for very specific subjects, I'll use the hairspray method. Hairspray I'll use for things that I want, like a lot of weathering. Like an oil drum or a vehicle that's seen a lot of wear and tear service, like a recovery vehicle or a maintenance vehicle, like a tow truck or an ammo hauler or something like that. Some vehicles that have seen a lot of wear and tear, or they're very old, like a tractor in a farmer's field kind of thing. That's heavily used and not repainted a lot, so it just rusts. So I would use it for that. The reason why is because with hairspray you can do a lot of tiny chips and large chips at the same time, and they're very, very random, right? So it's good for that, but it's very difficult to do just small chips in small areas and keep them that way, because to do that, all the area around where you've done that small chip is still compromised by the chipping fluid that you've done, because everything around it is still got the chipping fluid under it. So it's difficult to explain. So let's say I wanted to chip the area around the corner of this container here where the 371 is, and I only wanted to chip just this corner, right? I would have to apply the chipping fluid just around that corner. Now, after I chipped that corner, the areas beyond the chip are still compromised by the chipping fluid. So, and it would still stay that way even after I sealed it with a flat coat later, or with another gloss coat, however way I wanted, depending on what level of weathering I was going to do next. I would seal it with a gloss coat or seal it with a flat coat, depending on what's going on. But that hairspray is still there, and if any moisture got in there, it would reactivate it and compromise the paint that's still there. So, and I could actually even do it with my finger and accidentally rub it off and make the chip even bigger. So it's delicate. So I use the hairspray method for doing larger amounts of weathering, like on an oil drum type of thing. I wouldn't use it like on a Panther tank that's only seen like a month or 2 service and is still in active service. Or a Tiger tank, or even like a Panzer IV or something, or a Sherman tank that's only like 8 weeks old or something. that have almost no chips on them, right? I would use them on knocked out vehicles that, you know, have big burn marks on them and stuff like that, definitely, right? But for the vast majority of the time, I'll use paint because chips are smaller and more localized and more controllable that way. That's just the way I prefer to do it. But anyway. I was going to talk about the diorama for a second. The diorama itself, it's actually quite simple. I believe I showed it in the other videos, I think. It's that high-density pink foam insulation crap from Owens Corning Foam Ular. I buy it at a hardware store chain that's here in North America called Home Depot. And I buy it in a sheet that's about a meter and a quarter, or 2.25 meters long by 3/4 of a meter wide, and it's about maybe 15 centimeters thick, or 15 millimeters thick. And I just cut it in half and throw it in the back of the van, and then I drive home. And it's like $7 for a sheet. And that lasts me for 10 or 15 dioramas, right? So it's pretty cheap. And so I take it and I sand it first before I work on it, because it's got this kind of a heated skin on it. So when they make it, it's like it's all open poured, and then they heat it so that it closes all the pores and creates like a skin on the outside. So I sand it to open up all the pores again. It makes it easier to carve. So I only need to sand the piece that I'm working on, so it's not that big of a deal. This here is the same sort of stuff right here, but it's the white stuff. A friend of mine uses it as packing material when he sends me stuff. Now, if you can see it, I don't know if you'll be able to see it. I just saw it a second ago. It's got kind of a shine to it. You sand it so that shine is gone. That's that heated skin that they put on. It's just like they take a heat gun. They do it on an industrial scale, and it puts like a skin on it to make it smooth, right? But it's actually quite rough and open poured when you sand it, and that's the way you want it to be, because it's easier to carve. So, but anyway, so that's what the buildings are all made out of, and the base as well. This is all also the foam, and so I carve it with a stylus to make all the bricks and everything, and that was it. Blair Witch time. So these rubble piles are basically just piles of this that I've laminated and then carved it with a hobby knife to make it look like a kind of a pile sort of shape. And then I made a paste out of mud, like actual dirt, mixed with pieces of this rock up here, which is actually granite that I pulverized with a hammer. And some sand, some light colored sand that I happen to have, and mixed it all together to make like a paste, and threw in some PVA glue, and I painted it on the rubble piles up here and up there, and a little bit on the stairs and at the base of the building behind the, don't actually need this tank here anymore, and here in front of the building as well, right? And then I used a version of the same paste, but without the the rocks and the sand. So it's just the earth that's been kind of strained. So it's just like a powder. And I used it to do the stucco, the mud rendering on the building. And I used the actual color that it was in. So it's like this dark brown color, like a kind of a coppery brown color. And that's the color I wanted it to be. So I actually used real mud render to make the mud render on the bricks. And it dried and looks an awful lot like it does in the photo, the reference photo that I was going for. I mean, this is the building I used for reference. The roof, I stole that roof and put it on this building because I like that roof. It's basically just a bunch of planks with rocks sitting on top of it. And this year I used a sheet of plywood and put a bunch of rocks on top of it. So I kind of like the look of it. So either way, that's what I was going for. And I think it kind of worked. So essentially I built it sort of how it is in sort of reality, sort of. So once the thing was dry, I took some of the leftover pulverized granite and I sprinkled it over the rubble piles here, and I put them on top of the roof. And they're all glued there using Mod Podge to hold them there. Waited for that to dry. And then once it was dry, I took an eyedropper with some thin PVA glue in it and eyedroppered it all throughout it. And on the roof up here, I did the same thing. So it just kind of gives it an extra layer of hold. Waited for that to dry. And then I took a brush. Oh, wow, you saw my t-shirt for the first time. Yes, I have a t-shirt with my name on it. I took a brush like this and dipped it in some pastel chalk that I made. That's basically the same color as this. It's just white and some tan colored pastel chalk. And I did that and I went over all the vegetation that I glued on. Because the vegetation was, it was desert vegetation, but it was really, really bright. So I wanted to dust it up. So I dusted it with actual dust. And I did the rocks, all the rocks, all got dusted with the same stuff. And it sticks to it really tight, right? And then I waited, I don't know, about 10 or 15 minutes for it to settle. And then I misted it with a matte spray, like a, it's like a photo mount type, not a photo mount. It's a matte, a lacquer matte seal, basically. It stinks to all hell and gone. But I use it for spraying on dioramas to get rid of any kind of, when I use Mod Podge, sometimes it makes like the surface shiny. It doesn't always dry flat. Sometimes it makes it look like it's wet. So I use the that matte spray to kill any shine and stuff. And that's what it basically did. If there was any shine on it, it killed it. It's just a lacquer spray. Now, I don't recommend using lacquer on foam because it usually melts it. Unless it's been heavily coated with acrylic primers and paints and lots of seals, because if it manages to get through, it's just going to go bleh. You don't want to do that. So, but if you have an acrylic-based, totally acrylic-based can spray, I don't think there's such a thing. I think they all have some kind of a hot propellant in those acrylic spray things that will melt foam. So, you know, you can do the same thing with an airbrush, though. You know, take some, like, Galleria matte varnish and spray. The only reason I didn't do it is because I was lazy. I didn't want to hook up the airbrush. So I just had the can. And I knew it wasn't going to hurt it because this is all very heavily painted. It was me just being lazy. So. But anyway, so yeah, so I dusted all the plants with the dust, right, to make it look dusty. And then I located where I wanted the tank to go, and then I poked this here through the bottom, because that's where the screw is going to go to hold the tank on. Because I don't glue my tanks to my bases. I screw them to the base so I can remove them later when I throw the diorama in the garbage. It's easier to do. So the figures are going to hide in here. The Afghani freedom fighters are going to hide in here. There'll be, I think there's four of them. Yeah, there's four of them. They're going to be hiding in here, getting ready to blow the crap out of the Soviet tank. I might have some kind of curtain, like a burlap curtain hanging over here. That one guy, he's pulling it aside to look through. But that's about it. It's the only real decoration in there. I might build a small table and have it in this corner. In this corner here, I might have a small table here. Maybe a chair, if there's room. It's going to be pretty crowded in there with all those guys, so I don't know if I have room. One of the guys, if I can, I might have him over here, hiding in the rubble here, but I don't know if that's practical, so we'll see what happens. So anyway, I think that's about all I got on this. I don't have anything else. I yammered on quite a bit about it. Yeah, that's all I got. Anyway, if you guys want to join the group build, all you got to do is join the Facebook group. The link for the group is in the description of the video below, and you got to answer the entry questions. If you don't answer the entry questions, you can't get in. if you're a Trump-loving, gun-loving douchebag that hates immigrants and you're a racist douche canoe, you're not going to get in either, because we don't like those people. And if that makes us gatekeepers, then we're gatekeepers. We love being gatekeepers, if that's what they are. So, yay for us. I think that's all we got. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.